Hello, everybody. Thank you for being here. I'm Marina Kaczynski. I teach ceramics and drawing. And this is our third visiting artist series event for spring semester. Our next event will be on April 19th at 11. There'll be a lecture by Amanda Williams. And I wanted to introduce Kate Roberts. Kate Roberts received both her BFA and MFA from Alfred University, that has the top ceramics program in the country. She completed residencies at the Archie Bray Foundation in Montana and Anderson Ranch Art Center in Colorado, and additional artist residencies in Paris and in Italy. And her work has been exhibited at the Tampa Art Museum in Tampa, Florida, Evanston Museum in Syracuse, New York. Major exhibitions include Ensica Biennial twice in 2011 and 2015. Ensica is a ceramic organization that mostly known for holding a really large ceramic conference every year. Each time it's in a different state, and it draws thousands of visitors and artists and educators internationally. She is also the emerging artist, Ensica Emerging Artist for 2017, and she'll be presenting at the Ensica conference next week. And this summer, she will be participating in a ceramics biennial in Geneva, Switzerland. It'll be a residency and exhibition. And currently, she's a lecturer at the University of Washington in Seattle.
Thank you so much for inviting me here. It's been really great to explore within the studio a little bit and kind of do some experimentation. I find that sometimes lately I've been kind of like having to produce work for an exhibition or for something like that, and I've been a little bit less likely to kind of do some experimentation. And so this has been a really great opportunity to kind of do that for a little bit of time. As you came in, you were kind of looking at this picture, and I chose this picture because I believe it's one of the most accurate kind of representations of myself and where I came from, and also what underlines some themes that are in my work. So these pictures hang in my grandfather's garage in the mountains of North Carolina. I was born and bred in the South, and though the accent doesn't remain, there are some things that are permanently embedded in my being. And one of those things is my love of Dolly Parton. So you can see Dolly Parton, she's on the left. Another is, you know, I love fried chicken. I can't get enough of it. And but these things are kind of impermanently embedded in me. And there's also this curiosity about the past through the architecture and the objects that are around me. And with this comes this kind of haunting question of what if. So what I love about these two pictures is how they contradict each other. They show these two extremes. You know, they show Dolly Parton and they show George Washington on the other side of things. Two really hardworking individuals. But what I'm trying to find is that kind of moment in between. And for me, it's that rainbow clock, that thing that kind of connects the two together. And so in my work, I'm always talking about these qualities of accumulation and deterioration, solidity and transparency, entrapment and protection, and order and chaos. And I want what I make to kind of teeter on the edge of these two extremes. So growing up in the South, my first introduction to ceramics was that of the face jugs. So the one on the left is by Unknown, circa 1862, 1870. And then the one on the right is by yours truly, Kate Roberts, age 12, 2000. So I fell in love with this medium at a really young age, and it's kept my attention. So its ability to be manipulated into anything. It's just dirt, you know? But we can kind of manipulate it in so many different ways, and we can make it these really beautiful pieces. So it can either be hard, it can be rough, it can be wet, it can be vitreous, but all of these can come together to make something really beautiful. And it walks the line every time we put it into the kiln. So or if we don't put it in the kiln at the same time. And it's become this perfect medium for me to find that moment in between. So for centuries of artists have kind of presented their representations of what beauty is. And so I believe beauty is this personal journey. My version of beauty is once again finding that moment in between. So where reality and the ideal converge. And then for me, a certain romance is born from that. So the pursuit of beauty is deeply rooted in the ideals of Southern women. One of the most iconic characterizations of this is the woman Scarlett O'Hara from the biblical Southern novel Gone with the Wind. And the need to look her best is under any circumstance is no more evident than when in the scene where she repurposes her curtains to make a new dress for this ball that she's going to. So my undergraduate work reflected an interest in examining and understanding these ideals and how they affected women's clothing, stereotypes, and then their positions within society. What was most intriguing for me was the architecture of these dresses. Underneath the layers of this expensive fabric was a structure that was more akin to a cage. And I created two pieces in response to this, in which I stripped the dress down to its skeleton, connected it with this floral and bird imagery, and then I displayed it like a China doll. And the reason why I did it is I was trying to generate this discussion about centuries of women's struggles between the issue of appearance versus reality. And it was my hope that through making these, I could kind of begin to understand this a little bit. I was still, an undergrad, I was still kind of growing. I was still learning and developing. I still am, even today. But these were kind of some things that I was dealing with that time. So these pieces also kind of tested the limits of the ceramic material. So one of the most common description of a ceramic piece is that it's fragile. And I wanted to push this fragility to the extreme. So with one, movement or the whole piece could kind of break down. And at one point it did. And it did that right before I was to show it. I think I had a week before my senior show. And so I had to figure out other ways of kind of dealing with that. But I liked that fact that it kind of teetered on this edge. I wasn't quite sure. It had this extreme fragility to it. So I ended up having to engineer sets of molds, and I used the software Rhino to help me do that, so this 3D modeling software, and then a method of piping slip out of a cake decorating tube, and then finally I had to figure out a way to suspend these pieces. And so the picture on the bottom left is of the pieces in my studio, or my senior studio. So I had a really kind of small senior studio that I was working in. And every time I would put it together, it would fill up my whole studio. So then I'd have to take it apart so I could actually work. And then I'd kind of build it back. So, you can make work in any space. Like, it doesn't have to be huge or anything like that. But it was kind of revolutionary to me that you could then kind of take a piece down to parts and then store it really easily. Like, it almost took no space when it was stored. But when you put it back together, it took up so much volume. So these pieces, they were Scarlett and Melanie, and they became pivotal for me in developing this kind of view of beauty that I had and its connection to appearance. And Scarlett and Melanie tore down that facade of the Southern ideals of beauty that were created. And I became more interested in what's underneath it, or in other words, the reality of a situation, and how both these kind of external and internal forces could alter the surface, and in turn create a more developed, new, redefined beauty. So since then, my works kind of existed in this part as a result of nature, time, and circumstance. So they often depict the decay of an ideal, and it's a reflection and a response to, each piece kind of leads to another piece eventually. So right after I finished undergrad, I got a residency to go to Paris. And while I was there, I didn't have a studio space. I had kind of this like big open room. So, and I was there for 2 months. And so what I would do is each morning I'd pick an area on the map and I'd just go walk around and I'd take pictures. Or I'd pick a museum and I'd just go to this museum because this residency gave you kind of like a pass to go to a few different museums and some really odd museums, you know, the Kluge Museum and the one on kind of scientific instruments and some other, you know, very specific museums. And so I didn't quite know how any of this was going to eventually like affect any of my work, and I'm not even sure if any of it will eventually, but it was just the idea of kind of collecting all of this information in and seeing what I could do with it. So that ended up leading to this work that I made kind of in between undergrad and grad school. And one of the first things is I kind of digressed from working in the slip body material for a little bit. I kind of missed the physicality of touching clay and really working with it. And so, and I also was starting to kind of consider the reflection of mirrors, and it's something I'm still interested in. I kind of touched on it and I haven't really grabbed it much, and I'd like to kind of go back to it. But this black mirror is similar to some of the work that I kind of made during this ranch. I had a residency at Anderson Ranch, and then right after that I kind of moved around for a bunch in between undergrad and graduate school, and it was more of an experience of me trying to figure out where I wanted to be and what I wanted to do and what I wanted to, and if I wanted to continue making, and what would that kind of look like. So I worked, you know, I did a residency, then I would go work as a gallery assistant or a resident or another resident artist or an apprentice for someone. I was just trying to figure out how I wanted to make this, you know, what did I want to do? I spent the 3 years between undergrad and graduate school kind of quickly moving through places, you know. But then also, this kind of brought up this idea of permanence for me, and it questioned it. You know, what's the physicality of a home? And then in doing this research, I became obsessed with the decaying buildings of Detroit. So their physical appearance reminded me a little bit of the kudzu that I saw when I growing up in the South. And I find kudzu to be complete, you know, beautiful despite its ability that it can kind of overtake anything in its path. There's this kind of push and pull between nature and humanity. So nature bears life, humans fight against it, nature takes life, humans fight against it once more, but nature kind of has this final say and kind of decides how it's all going to work. And without question, there's this cycle that continues to build. And so, though these pieces are, you know, or these places are made out of two different materials, there's something very similar to each of them. And there's this kind of moment of release that happens as well. So this is the work, some of those qualities I started to use in this work that was a series titled Grief. And these pieces, these are what I kind of then applied to graduate school with. And they were based on the contemporary collection of photographs by the 100 Abandoned Houses Project by Detroit photographer Kevin Bauman. And I reflected on a decaying city that appeared abandoned, overgrown, vandalized, and slowly wiped away. And in deciding how I was gonna photo, you know, the photograph became a huge part of these pieces. You know, they, for the most part, people will not necessarily see your work in person. They will see your work through a photograph. And so I was thinking of like, how can my photograph discuss how the emotion or what I'm trying to evoke from the viewer, how's that going to work? So I was looking at these photographs by Robert Mapplethorpe and these kind of very dark photographs and how he photographed the body and the light that happened and the reflection. And I had seen these while I was like studying abroad in Florence during undergrad. And they were showed in conjunction with some pieces by Michelangelo that were being made, and I thought this dark color and the stoic presentation, you know, I wanted these pieces that I weren't making, that I was making, to be this kind of permanent monument to the ruins around us today. So with this inspiration in mind, I questioned, you know, once again, whether this photograph could be the final piece, you know, and how could I do that? And so I used some of those ideas that I had seen within the Robert Mapplethorpe photographs in order to kind of highlight that within these and glamorize these kind of stages of decay. And so this is another last one. So these pieces ended up becoming part of a show that I curated. I was living back in Alfred for about, which is where I went to undergrad and graduate school. I was living there for about 6 months, kind of in between situations. And it's kind of like it became my home base to kind of come back to. And while I was there, they have a little small gallery that's for alumni. And I asked if I could curate a show there with some alumni that were kind of working in similar disciplines as I was, or were working with similar themes of work. And so it was a show that I curated at this gallery called the Cohen Gallery. And, you know, I was interested in showing work, and I realized that one way of doing that, you know, I wasn't necessarily getting to show, like I wasn't being asked to show, you know, I was having a hard time getting into shows. So I was like, well, you know what? I'm just gonna take it in my own hands and I'm gonna make a show. Like, I'm going to curate my own show and show my work in that way. So I kind of took that on, and it gave me a deadline to make work. And then kind of, because at the time I was like working as a studio assistant and had like a substitute teacher job, I was doing all these kind of different things at the same time, and it gave me this deadline to get some stuff done. And so it set a goal for myself. And so I think you know, it's definitely something to do. So it was based on, it was called Fascinations with Decay. And it was based on this book by Paul Zucker, in which he kind of talked about the zeitgeist of the 21st century, meaning like, you know, what is going to be the image of this time that talks about this time period that we have. And so the work, I had pieces by, let me go back to this one. This one is a piece by, her name's Alexis Grabowski. She draws these, she used to live, now she lives in Maine, but she used to live in Brooklyn, and so she would go around and take pictures and then draw these really delicate, intricate drawings of decaying areas around town. And then I also had the work by Walter McConnell, who was a professor at Alfred, so it was really easy to kind of collect people who were within that area too, to like show in the show. And so he made this kind of smaller piece that was an unfired piece. And as time, you know, it was a piece that as time went on, it would slowly erode and decay. The way that I've kind of structured the last part of, or the next kind of grouping of things is, you know, I went to graduate school. And so I was looking, while I was in graduate school, I was trying to find all this kind of inspiration and like, where could I find it? And this was a image that I found. I was just in a bookstore and I was just flipping through a book and I found this, and I thought that this was such a, it looked like a cage in a way, like the way that this had been put together. And so it appears one way, you know, but it can kind of allude to something completely different. So in graduate school, I returned to back to working with this slip material, and I made this series called The Study of Figures. And so their shapes are kind of reminiscent of a human. So they're about the scale of kind of a human scale. But they also were reminiscent of decorative cages. And, you know, though cages are ordinarily made out of metal, these were once again made out of that really fine, thin slip material. And they were kind of hung. And so they took on this sense of temporality and maybe could read as an exoskeleton of something that had been there before. And I started to experiment a little bit about the surface. Like, what else could I kind of compound on there? So I started to put sand and dirt and fiber, and I started to build up these crevices. And they began to take on the character much like Spanish moss, which I had been kind of around when I was growing up. And there was this tension that was created between the assumption of a cage and then all of these other materials kind of building up on top of them, that it could kind of break apart over time. You know, for me, they were kind of lingering between these two different states. Like, you could either decide they were becoming or they were kind of wiping away. They kind of were in this in-between stage. So one of the hardest things that I realized in graduate school was for an artist to turn something that's kind of ephemeral, such as an emotion, into something that's physical. And so the dancer, Martha Graham, she really wanted her dances to be felt by the viewer. And the piece, Lamentation, is about this grieving mother. She represents this ephemeral feeling of grief by contorting her body that is wrapped up in this stretchy cylindrical form. And, you know, the final images are really sculptural when you look at them. And so they informed this other body of work that I made called Cat on the Hot Tin Roof, in which I wanted to talk about the structure of a family and kind of the situation of how it's put together. And I did this by talking about the living room area. And then I was thinking about, well, what if something becomes too affected by an emotion? You know, how can you kind of show that? How can you show, what does that look like? And so I had this kind of single focus light that created this atmosphere in the room, and then kind of there started to be these kind of moments of these feelings of depression that happened. And sometimes I look at this piece and I think it worked, and then I think it didn't work. I go back and forth between it. It forces, you know, the light kind of forces the viewer to look at that. It's a spotlight. You have to really approach and be part of that space. And then I thought, you know, it led to this. I started working a little bit with unfired clay, with temporal pieces. So what did it look like when the interior of a piece was completely gone? You know, how could I suspend a structure? What did that look like? And what happened, you know, what could remain? And so this is, in this piece, containment, the fiber dipped in slip overlays this figure much like a blanket draped over a form. So the hollow form is suspended by what once was. And it's kind of like this blanket draped over a form. And its unfired state alters a shell's inherent quality of permanence. And though still standing at any moment, it could collapse within that. And so I talked to you guys a little bit about, or I talked to some of you who were at my demos yesterday. I have this vase of dead flowers that I carry around with me everywhere I move. And so I've had it for about 5 years. So it kind of like, it has to move with me, because the reason it has to move is what I'm interested in is all of this like dust that's kind of accumulated on top of it over time and what that looks like. And so these pieces were based on that. These pieces were based on this kind of accumulated fiber that began to kind of embody this emotion that I was projecting onto them. And so these pieces are iconic. You know, these are iconic of mansions and their topiaries. You know, I wanted to unmask their kind of vulnerability. And so once again, this kind of idea that nature comes full circle. It doesn't discriminate. You know, items symbolic of wealth, status, grandeur are kind of not safe from this. And so my thesis show kind of was the culmination of all these kind of ideas that I was working through in graduate school. And I made this decision that I didn't want to show in a white gallery. I wanted to go find a place and to really investigate that place and to make a piece that was very site specific. And so the town over from us in Hornell, New York, there was this decaying post office. It was, you know, the interior, the exterior looked one way, it looked fine. And then when you went into the inside of it, anything that had like remotely reminded you that it was a post office had been torn out. But there were some remnants that were left in there. So there were these kind of marble floors. There was some really ornate kind of molding that was around there. But the post office had gone through many different things. Like at one point it had been, it was the offices for the school district there. Or another moment it had been like another office building for another kind of community or something that happened, or that was a business within there. But anyways, this person had finally kind of bought it, and he allowed me to go in there and kind of do this installation in this space. So anyways, I studied the space. You know, I wanted to kind of understand the way it got there, you know, really look at kind of the mint green paint chips, the pink marble floors. You know, what once was this? And then how could I kind of comment on that? So in the largest area, this is where the mail would have been sorted out. There was this huge room and there was all this water damage. And so I started to create these kind of puddles that if you were standing in there, they looked as if they were kind of moving in one direction. So there was this sense of kind of movement as they went. And there was this single light that referenced for me the moon. So it started to have, it was a piece that you could kind of look at during the day, but it was even, I just really loved it at night, because it was just only certain areas were really illuminated. And I used these pieces of debris that I collected from my studio. So these were all these kind of past things that I had made, and I used them to set up to prop up the surface. And so there was this kind of tension created between the presence of moving people. So what's really, like, one misstep in this kind of stillness could be shattered. And there would be, it was really interesting watching people because, you know, some people were really, like, aware of where they were walking. And then some people would just start talking, you know, and then they'd all of a sudden, like, step on something. And it, you know, in those moments, like, you, I hate to, it goes back to this other artist that I am reminded of in which, you know, there's this sense of like somebody else like accidentally hurting your work. And for me, that was just this kind of, I kind of embraced it. Like I wasn't upset about it. And I had learned a little bit before then when I had made those armchairs that like laid on the ground, that it's really hard to put something on the ground because people like are very unaware of where they are. There's also something about that that's really interesting to me and that I want to kind of explore. So I finished graduate school about a year ago and I moved to Madison, Wisconsin. So I was teaching at the University of Wisconsin for a year. And every time I move, I get kind of uprooted and I have to really kind of figure out my place again and kind of figure out what I'm gonna work on or how I'm gonna do. And I also had this switch, you know, I just made this kind of huge installation in graduate school and I was looking to make something that maybe either was a little bit more temporary or was fast or that I could kind of manipulate very easily. And so I always go back to, you know, these are images that I took in Paris. So I have this kind of folder of all that, those images that I kind of collect throughout the years. And whenever I'm kind of feeling stuck or lost or can't figure out where I'm going to go next, I go back to this group of images and I kind of pull from them. And so I went and I was looking and there was this gate that, you know, that I loved the drawing of it. And this was kind of an image that I'd seen there. And so I decided to create this port, this gate piece that also looked kind of like scenery from a theater stage. And so, you know, the theater is all about smoke and mirrors, which is, you know, basically the equivalence of appearance versus reality. And it's, you know, this piece ended up being made out of unfired porcelain that was dipped in fiber. And I started working in this way because there was also this moment at the end of grad school where I like looked and I had all this stuff. And I was like, I don't know what to do with this. Like, how am I gonna, you know, I don't wanna move with it. I don't know what to do. You know, it was just all permanently fired things. And so I started thinking about how, you know, there was part of me that wanted to be able to reuse a material over and over again. And there was this dream and it's kind of figuring out, but to be able to go to a site and make the piece there. And so the only, you know, for me, the way of doing that was to work with unfired clay, to make these very site-specific, very temporary installations. And so what I love about this way of working is that I can, you know, after I finish it, I can slake it back down. I can, you know, I can take this all down, put it in a bucket of water, and then reuse the material again, and then make something completely different. But also what I love about this is that I can cut things away, and that if I don't like something, I can take it really easily away. You know, I don't have the problem where I finished firing it, and sometimes this is a problem, sometimes it's not, but I finished firing it, and I don't like something, and I need to change it in some way, and I want to immediately change the form. So these started to give me that opportunity to do this. And then it also gave me the opportunity to work on a much larger scale. So, and also being able to ship kind of these fragile pieces that I was wanting to make. So these pieces, though they may look fragile, the fiber in the clay is actually really strong. And so they were just a way to kind of get that feeling, that very wispy, that very thin line, but to be able to also make it so that it kind of stayed and it stuck. And then if it did break, once I got to the location, I could fix it really easily. So I can cut away, you know, I can add quickly, I can kind of change these at a drop of the hat. But there's still, you know, I'm still kind of figuring out, this is all kind of new to me, and I haven't fired much work in the last year or so. because I'm trying to figure out this vocabulary that I'm using. Like, how do I work with this? And right now I've been kind of trying to, you know, do I add more materials to it? Do I add certain types of texture? And one way this started to go is I started to add colorant to the pieces. And so this is a piece that I installed back home called the indigo curtain. And in the South, indigo was a kind of a cash crop from the 1800s. And then, you know, once slavery was gotten rid of, they didn't have anybody to work the fields anymore. So this crop or this material kind of disappeared. Or it kind of became like even more like expensive to make because it's a very labor-intensive process. So I wanted to talk about that fact that this thing that made people really rich, depending on the certain people that could kind of have access to it or could make it or do something, that could change, you know, and that could also change the idea of like what your status is based on like how, you know, certain things happen within society. And so that we're all kind of not, you know, we might think that we're impervious to these things, but it all kind of comes full circle again. This is a close-up of this piece. So, you know, it was using the stain that I was kind of painting onto the surface, and it's something that I still would like to respond to a little bit. And then this is one of the last pieces that I've been working on lately in my studio, and this is called bowing. I always look at it and say bowing, but I mean bowing. So to bow at the end of, you know, a performance and to kind of fall in certain ways. And so this piece was also one where I started to kind of add other elements to it, such as this kind of wire to kind of create, you know, so that it doesn't lay in one straight line, that it has a little bit more movement to it as you look and walk around it. And I love these kind of moments where the pieces sometimes break apart within shipping. And sometimes I fix those, and then sometimes I just kind of leave them because I like, you know, the idea of the process, the change within that. And then the last, recently my work's kind of changed a little bit. I started doing these dust prints. So I will screen print glue, and then I will dust clay on top of it, and then create these kind of these ghostly images that come back through the surface. And you know, these buildings, I'm using these buildings that are buildings that were destroyed, that were not kind of protected, that these were some kind of architectural marvels or really important, but because of situations such as it might have been war, it might have been somebody needed to build a road, or it might not have been aesthetically pleasing for the time that they were kind of torn down and taken away. And so these moments, you know, it's just about the dust, it's about the ground, it's about the earth, and how that kind of ends up being just this kind of mirage or this kind of faintly image. So I always like to end my talks by kind of talking to you about things that don't work out. So I showed you all the things that worked out. And then, but for everything that kind of works out, there's always these things that don't work out. So all those pieces that I showed you, you know, they went through these processes of, you know, that I had a bunch of failures to get to that point. So, you know, the top or the one to the left, you know, that's a piece that I came in one day, and I happened to have this studio in grad school that always leaked. And whenever it would leak, it sometimes would like start to kind of accumulate on the surface, and then things might fall. So for instance, this happened. It kind of leaked and things fell. And so I came back in and it was in this kind of a million pieces, and like, how do I kind of deal with that? And then, you know, these kind of those last few vases that I, you know, when I fire things, I often fire, when I do fire them, I fire them a bunch of times. And so at the last time, it just kind of like fell over in the kiln. So it's just like, then we had to kind of figure out a way to get it back up, you know, and I really thank all my grad school friends for getting poked, you know, by all this kind of really sharp material as they tried to help me bring it up there. But all of these things, you know, like I tried to figure out how to make this chair before. And the first time I put it in the kiln, you know, I don't have a picture. This is the other thing. You should always take pictures in progress, because I do not have a picture of what it looked like before. I only have a picture of what it looked like after it came out of the kiln and it was all flat because it had kind of fallen apart. So there's kind of these lessons that I'm still learning about taking things like as they go. But it kind of reminded me of this, I always think about this quote, that's from this book. It's this guy named Murakami, and it's the Wind-Up Bird Chronicles. And what he says in this, what we see before us is just one tiny part of the world. We get into the habit of thinking, this is the world, but that's not true at all. The real world is a much darker and deeper place than this, and most of it is occupied by jellyfish and things. We just happen to forget all that, don't you agree? 2/3 of the Earth's surface is ocean, and all we can see of it with the naked eye is the surface, the skin. We hardly know about what's beneath the skin. So there's just this kind of idea of like looking beneath the skin, looking for something a little bit deeper. So anyways, thank you so much for kind of listening, and I'll take questions, I guess, if there's anything. Yes?
The sculpture from when you were 12, I noticed that one of the eyebrows was yellow.
The sculpture from?
Like the head?
Face jug.
Oh, the face jug.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that wasn't me. I didn't make that piece.
No, I mean the one to the right.
Well, I was 12.
Yeah, I was just curious.
So I was.
If the yellow was.
Oh, you mean those are like they were boogers? They were boogers.
Oh.
You know, they were like these kind of boogers coming out of the nose.
That's pretty funny.
Yeah.
I thought it was a mustache.
I love that we're talking about this piece.
The ones we had of the cages.
Oh, this
is
one.
Is the light in it or cast through
it? It's cast through it. So I really love looking at the shadows that are created. I think there's this, first of all, they're kind of like a ghost. They're this kind of echo of the piece for me. I don't look at them as like happy accidents. They sometimes are like, for me, actually part of the work. You know, especially when I'm building the gate pieces, like I think about the shadow a ton as I'm building them and what I want the shadow to look like. Like for instance, this piece, the last piece that I just made, you know, there was a part of me that wanted it to look like you had just turned down this, it's kind of like a film noir like scene where you like just turned down this like alley and like there's just like the light is like hitting it at a certain point and there's these shadows created from it. And so I wanted it to kind of fill the room because I often use them also to kind of continue to fill the room and the space from it. So yeah, they're a lot of importance. But yeah, no, I don't normally put like a light source in them. I usually have the light source outside coming through. Yes?
One of the broken cages you told us, were you trying to like put it back together somehow or like recreate it or what
did
you
end up? I ended up recreating it because it was a funny situation. I had, that piece had just been accepted into a show and then I seriously went in the next day and looked and it was in a million pieces on the ground. So there was this moment of like, I had to figure out like, well, could I see if they would take something else or could I, and there's been a lot of situations where I've had to learn how to ship things, you know, because I've shipped work before and it didn't make it. You know, and then it's kind of like I have to have a backup option or I have to be there with like glue gun in hand that I'm going to glue things back together. So it kind of changed, you know, I'm still like there's still this huge learning process and learning curve to what I'm doing. But yeah, I think I ended up remaking that and kind of altering it a little bit. I kind of pulled a situation where I didn't tell them that it had happened. It was just like, all right, I'll fix this. Like I'll make it. It'll be fine. Like it'll look fine, but yeah. Yes?
How do you ship the pieces or like move them at all? Like the bowing, like did you make that at the space or how did you transport that?
I cut, so what I do is I make it in my studio, completely in my studio. And then the way that I do it is I can cut them apart because I can always put them back together when I get there. I can just put more clay and slip and, you know, kind of meld the seams back together where they kind of came apart. With these pieces, I use huge mattress boxes. And I use kind of the insulation foam. It's like that pink foam that you can get at Home Depot or Lowe's or something like that. And I back the pieces with that. I mean, for the most part, nothing really happens to them. And if it does happen to them, I can easily fix it once it gets there. It's very different than the fired pieces that I was making. The fired pieces, for a long time, I would take apart and I would ship them in panels. So I'd ship them so that that dress piece from the very beginning, it was shipped from South Carolina to California one time, but I took it all apart and like really bubble wrapped each piece. And yeah, I try, yeah, it's a, it happened from a learning, I mean, cause one of those cages I tried to, I had this grand idea that I would just suspend it in a crate, and that if I just put enough padding on the sides and it kind of went back and forth, it would make it. And then I seriously got there and opened the box up, and it was just like little pieces all on the bottom of the on the thing, because I didn't take into account the bumpiness of the, you know, it's just like these things that I'm still learning. So luckily I had just picked up a piece from another show that was similar to that, and so I asked if I could like switch them around, but I hate doing that. Like, it's just, that's not, I don't like doing that. And so I've tried really hard to kind of figure out ways of getting around that so that that doesn't happen again.
For the dress one, I was wondering about when you were writing it with the tape tools you said,
mm-hmm.
What did you use to make the clay like able to go through it, or did you just use the clay itself? Did you use slip?
Yeah, I used slip. I used this, it was kind of a self-glazing slip, so I would only fire it once. There was some research that I did during undergrad. Like, there was this class that was taught during undergrad where there would be these students that would, it was kind of like a cooking class in that way, but you would do all these tests on clay bodies and materials. And there was this recipe book, and I looked through this recipe book and I found this slump body material that would conform to whatever shape, you know, during the firing that you put it in. And so I did my own kind of testing on top of that. And it's just ended up being just two materials, and it looks a lot like porcelain, but it's self-glazing. And so when you put it, you know, I had these molds and they were ceramic, but I'd have to put a material between the ceramic mold and the slip so that it wouldn't stick, you know, during the firing. That's the way that I kind of, you know, sometimes I bring that stuff out every once in a while and kind of make using it, but not a huge amount. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So do you sketch it first, or you just kind of like,
do I sketch before? A little bit of both. I usually kind of know what shape. My sketches are not fully developed. I will say that. It's something that I really kind of need to pursue a little bit more. But I also look at sketching as it's not, I do some drawings before, but I also use sketching as a way of collecting images and collecting like designs that I want to use. But for the most part, when I start to make like a gate piece now, I'm kind of informed by what the decisions are as I'm like building something. So it kind of happens as it goes, which I find really freeing, because for a really long time, I like needed to know how every single step will go. And like these dust prints that I'm doing are a little bit less freeing too at the same time because of that. And so I go back and forth between this. I mean, I do like having something that's a little bit more structured, and I like having something that I can kind of make how I need it to be. So, yeah.